You can't reach those big guns, and they just keep dropping in. There's nothing you can do. It's just like being a big bullseye on top of a hill, and you're just sitting there waiting. You can't be safe. You can be lucky. That's it.
Stuff landing all over, bouncing off you, and get just as scared every time. And it gets worse. The closer they get, the more they throw. The more you get scared.
September 1967. American Marines under siege at a base called Contien. No longer were Americans simply advising the Vietnamese. They were fighting their own battles, and their numbers were steadily increasing. So were other numbers.
Emergency medevac ASAP.
The toll of American dead and wounded in Vietnam. As the casualties mounted, so did the anti-war movement back home.
All of you big strong men, Uncle Sam needs your help again. He's got himself in a terrible jam, way down yonder in Vietnam. So put down your books and pick up a gun. I'm gonna have a whole lot of fun. And it's one, like a two, like a three. What are we fighting for? Don't ask me, I don't give a damn. Next stop is Vietnam. And it's five, six, like a seven. Open up the pearly gate.
These were the years of escalation, 1965 through 68. The buildup was enough at the time to keep the war from being lost. It was not, and would not be, enough to win. To understand the scope of the American buildup in Vietnam, you need only look at the figures for a few years. The first American combat troops arrived in March of 1965. By the end of that year, almost 200,000 American fighting men were in Vietnam. By the end of 1966, it was almost 400,000. A year later, almost 500,000. At the end of 1968, almost 540,000. The reason for the buildup was clear. The enemy was building also, infiltrating men and weapons into South Vietnam. As he raised the ante, so did we. The commitment was more than manpower. It also was firepower, as Dan Rather reported.
This is the 25th Infantry Division, the newest troops in South Vietnam for the United States. This is part of their first heaviest action.
Like most of our troops, they have been taught to depend on firepower, and depend on it they do. The objective is to push the Viet Cong back, at least 1/2 mile from brigade headquarters and the rest of the base camp. What is wanted is not only a camp, but a clear area all around the camp, so the enemy cannot sneak in close, unnoticed.
We have taken a few casualties. We've seen Viet Cong in there. And what we're really trying to do is to avoid presenting what I call a cheap shot approach for this guy. He has to come out where we can see him to do us any damage. We have been conducting a grind and destroy operation out there. We're going to just to take this brush and this trees and other materials out to the hooches and to make this place just like a golf course. Primary purpose being that we move him back about 250, 300 meters, and you're going to have to be extremely lucky to get aim small arms fire in there to do any real damage to.
Every everything in the modern army's book is thrown into clearing this one-half-mile sector. Included is the new flame-throwing armored personnel carrier. Brush is quickly cleared, stacked, soaked with gasoline, and burned. Heavy artillery, including 175mm guns, pours shells on top of and well behind the enemy's believed fixed positions and along suspected routes of movement.
Deflection! 3-2-6-3!
Deflection! 3-2-6-3!
Quadrant 5-3-7!
Quadrant 5-3-7!
There's small arms fire crackling from that thicket. There's been so much firing, 2 hours of it now, machine gun barrels are burning out and have to be replaced. If there are any enemy dead or wounded, the enemy has hauled them out. None are seen. No U.S. casualties are reported, not in these few hours anyway, but there have been at least 6 dead and 49 wounded the past 72 hours. The Viet Cong tries to make a practice of picking on newly arrived American units. The newly arrived 25th Division is no exception. Dan Rather, CBS News, with the 25th Division, South Vietnam.
The fighting was often like that in Vietnam. The enemy largely unseen, his casualties unknown. What Americans did know was that they were fighting a skilled and determined enemy. No one knew that better than the American commander, General William Westmoreland.
The Viet Cong is physically tough. Mentally courageous. He gets an awful lot of mileage out of minimum resources. He can endure an awful lot of hardship. He's a good tactician. His time and space factors that come into play as he plans his maneuvers are professional. He executes these tactical maneuvers with a high degree of professionalism. He's cunning. He's an enemy to be respected.
Westmoreland repeatedly asked for reinforcements, and repeatedly he got them. Young men drafted, trained, transported to the far side of the world. The average age of Americans fighting in Vietnam was 19. To them, arriving in Vietnam was like entering a new world. John Lawrence reported the first day of one American soldier.
PFC Thomas Lyle is writing a letter home to his mother and father in Johnstown, Pennsylvania. Tom Lyle has not seen his parents since last summer. He was drafted early May of last year. He has a lot to write about.
Dear Mom and Dad, it is now 2 a.m. in the Eastern Time Zone, so as you can see, I'm exactly halfway around the world.
Lyle! Thomas M. Elgin!
Yeah. First name. We went ashore in something resembling the Staten Island Ferry. 5 miles in 20 minutes, crowded in like sardines. There was an army captain on the little boat who told us what it would be like.
Gentlemen, welcome to Vung Tau. This is the Riviera of the Orient.
My own first impression of Vietnam when we stepped ashore was that it bore more resemblance to Fort Gordon, Georgia than it did to the Riviera. It took us a long time to get a truck out here to Cu Chi. There was a warning that we might possibly get daylight sniper fire along the way, so we rode shotgun all the way out. But luckily it proved unnecessary. The camp is a vast dust bowl. It's impossible to stay clean, I think we'll be reasonably comfortable here. An old acquaintance, another medic, came around to see me this morning. It was Warren Rainey, who was in the same platoon with me in Hawaii 6 months ago. He's been in Vietnam for several months and was wounded last week. He told me what it's like here. The first time that you see a man shot, is that the worst time? I mean, does it come easier from then on?
I think it does. First time you see a man wounded in battle, you're kind of shocked yourself. But after that, you're over the numbness of it. You can treat faster and better.
We're getting hot chow, which is more than I expected. The food isn't bad at all, considering what it was like on the boat. I drink a lot of water, soda, pineapple juice, cold milk, anything I can get my hands on. I have an insatiable thirst out here. We don't intend to have any action for a while. I can't tell what's going to happen from 1 hour to the next, but I feel pretty confident that whatever it is will turn out all right. As you know, I never wanted to come here in the first place, but I don't think it's going to bother me, and I might even enjoy it. Well, I'll write more at the first opportunity. Your loving son,
PFC
Tom.
Thomas Lyle's first letter home after his first day in Vietnam. This is John Lawrence, CBS News, Cu Chi, Vietnam.
Private Lyle and the hundreds of thousands who preceded and followed him were there because the commander-in-chief had sent them. The commander-in-chief was the President of the United States, Lyndon Johnson, and he was determined not to lose this war. In October 1966, the President paid a surprise visit to the American base at Cameron Bay. Bill Stout was there.
With the U.S. commander at his side, General William Westmoreland, the President flew to Cameron Bay on the shore of the South China Sea. Thousands of troops, some of them brought in from field units only a few miles away, only a few miles from the fighting, had been told a short while earlier that their commander-in-chief was on his way. There has been nothing like it since President Roosevelt's visit to North Africa in the wartime year of 1943. No president has been closer to battle since Abraham Lincoln walked the lines outside Washington during the Civil War. Mr. Johnson reviewed the troops and then awarded the Distinguished Service Cross to half a dozen men singled out for exceptional bravery. And then the president talked to the men about his journey across the Pacific.
I came here today for one good reason. Simply because I just could not come to this part of the world and not come to see you. You have the prayers of a grateful president and of a grateful nation. And I hope through each of you to take this message to all of you. We believe in you. We know you're going to get the job done. And soon, when peace can come to the world, we will receive you back in your homeland with open arms, with great pride, and with great thanks. Thank you.
Listening crowd of 8,000. Not exactly a campaign audience, but the president gave the men the Johnson treatment. Moving in among them, shaking hands, the pressing of the flesh.
Throughout these years of escalation, two wars were being fought simultaneously. One was the military war, the war of firefights and airstrikes. But the other war was political, the struggle to win the loyalty of the people of Vietnam. In some ways, that was more difficult than the military struggle. Charles Collingwood reported this other war.
Do you see those men in the purple camouflage suits helping with the harvest? They carry guns, but they are not soldiers. They are the government's secret weapon in its new strategy of winning back the peasants of Vietnam. They were trained for their job under the auspices of the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency. Their job is to undo what the Viet Cong did in places like this. They are, in effect, our VC. They belong to what is called a rural construction team. For 13 weeks, this team will live in the hamlet, directing and sharing in the task of putting back together the pieces of a way of life disrupted by the war. To get their message across, The team must win the trust and affection of the villagers. This householder, a carpenter, complains that the repair of the new bridge into town is behind schedule, and he can't get the materials he needs. They promise to try to speed it up. As a matter of fact, the new bridge is coming along pretty well, considering the thoroughness with which the Viet Cong destroyed the old one. Presiding over the effort is Major Bay, the deputy province chief for Binh Dinh, and the spark plug of the revolutionary development program in the province. Major Bay is a remarkable man. It's largely due to his leadership that the rural construction program is working better in Binh Dinh than anywhere else in South Vietnam. Once a week, an American medical team from an army hospital in Quy Nhon comes to Tin Yang to do a little doctoring. Medicine is terribly important in rural Vietnam, if only because there is so little of it. These people, in a country ridden by tropical infection, can live their whole lives and die without ever seeing a doctor. The rural construction cadres watch what the American medics do so that they can do some simple healing when the Americans aren't there. There is nothing going on in Tin Yang that is more significant than the amount of building and repairing that is underway. Something like a third of the dwellings in the hamlet were damaged either by the Viet Cong or by friendly air and artillery when they drove the Viet Cong out. Now the people are rebuilding in the old primitive way they've always built. The rural construction program must be doing something right in Tin Yang. People don't build houses unless they think they're going to stay. To make sure that they're going to stay, the villagers must learn to defend themselves against the roving bands of Viet Cong which still infest the area. The rural construction cadres teach them how. They show them how to make a simple grenade launcher and how to rig it as a booby trap against the infiltrating Viet Cong. One of the cadres plays the part of the VC, crawls toward the hidden wire at the corner of the fence. It's only smoke, but this is only a training exercise. Everyone has a job to do in defending the hamlet, from the kids on lookout who race in with the word that the Viet Cong are coming, to the oldest man. One man's job is to sound the alarm on the hamlet gong and summon everyone to his post. The villagers and the rural construction cadres run to the rice fields to take up defensive positions. It's only an exercise, but it's important to give the people confidence that they can defend themselves. They know the real thing could happen any night.
The pacification programs made some headway here and there, but not enough to change the course of the war. And the course of the war itself was hard to follow. Who was winning or losing? How could you measure that? One measure in a conventional war is real estate. Which army controls what land? But in Vietnam, the real estate seemed less important than hunting and killing the enemy. What you're about to see is a rare look at what that war was like. The struggle for one hill, down here where Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia all come together. The battle was filmed by Eric Dershmead and narrated by John Lawrence.
There is a hill in Vietnam, a nameless, uninhabited hill known only by a number, 943, 943 meters high. This is a story of the men of Alpha Company who tried to take that hill. In particular, it is the story of three men. Jim Buckner, 26, private first class, a draftee. In private life, he is manager of his father's restaurant in Derby, New York.
Next one after this one.
Bruce Black, 21, a California college dropout. He threatened to go over the hill rather than go to Vietnam. In a year, he is promoted to sergeant.
I'll tell you, you get on one of them anyway.
You definitely get on one of them.
J.C., Harry Charles Joseph Coombs, 29, from Georgia. Married, two children. One third of his life in the Army, a sergeant. A career soldier for $615 a month.
Attention,
J.C., the professional, Bruce Black, the college kid, and Jim Buckner, the draftee, have become friends in their 4 months in Vietnam. They share an equal dislike for their one-year tour of duty. Black calls it a jail sentence. The last day of November, 1967. Alpha Company, 3rd Battalion, 12th Infantry, 4th Division, advances on Hill 943, a half mile away. Their own artillery pounds the area around the men, as close as 100 yards. There are 114 men in the patrol, 4 platoons, 16 squads. JC leads a heavy weapons squad in 2nd platoon. A Company has been in the field for 10 days. 10 days of walking, crawling through the jungle. 8, 10 hours a day. It has been 2 weeks since serious contact with the enemy.
Hey, you can't pull it. It's on there.
The Colonel, Battalion Commander Jamie Hendricks, codename Grizzly.
Well, we let you down to hurt you in time.
Okay,
ready on again.
Okay, give you all put it down.
Grizzly recalls this mission.
We're making a reconnaissance ahead of the rifle companies, which are moving overland to 943. Intelligence has reported that the enemy occupies 943. And we always make it a habit of making a visual reconnaissance from the air before our elements on the ground move into it. I'm thinking about the route the enemy companies are covering on the ground below me. Making this reconnaissance as close to treetop level as possible in order to get a better view down through the trees. And coming over Hill 943, we just made a sharp bank with a chopper. Suddenly there was an explosion, and then suddenly a mass of red smoke. The aircraft had been hit by a 50 caliber anti-aircraft gun. One round came in about 3 inches past my left foot, went up through my radio equipment, and detonated a red smoke grenade I had hanging on my radio. It came out through a clipboard I was writing on top of the radio, and it was metal fragments from the grenade and parts of the radio that hit me in the face.
That's as close as I want to come.
Yes, sir.
A landing zone must be cut and blasted so that helicopters can bring in supplies. One soldier has been hit by a falling tree.
What's wrong with him, Doc?
Could be shot, could be
pain, could be headache. What's his pulse?
120.
Is he working on the LZ?
Yes, he was.
Behind the tree?
Alpha Company's commander, Captain David Foy.
Went behind the tree, curved back, and hit him.
Must have it. Yeah.
An airstrike. 1,000-pound bombs to blast the hill. Strikes and the artillery pound the hill throughout the night. Alpha Company has reached the base of Hill 943. The patrol begins. A reconnaissance squad is on the point up ahead. JC, Buckner, and Black with 2nd Platoon in the rear. 50 yards from the top, the point squad is ambushed. The word is passed down the hill. Alpha Company has taken casualties.
You guys hear how bad he was hit? Did you hear anything about it?
Buckner.
Hey, Rip.
JC.
Tell him to be real careful. One guy got hit. Be looking out real good.
Hey, Jim.
Black.
Tell him not just to watch up in the trees, but for spider holes like that later on. Yeah.
Buckner's fire team is 50 yards from the front.
You think they dug in?
I think they used. They probably left a handful behind. Snipers and then spider holes. Set them up in them trees and... spider hole. There probably ain't more than 5 of them, at the most. They leave them back more for harassment than anything else. If they can get a couple, okay. If we go up online, they'd probably pull out. Just makes it a little harder, that's all.
There's a lull as Alpha Company waits for an airstrike. JC.
Makes it so bad over here, you can't even see the people you're shooting at. They just fire at you, and you just hear the sounds, and that's it. You can't see them good. The only time you see them, really, is when they're dead. That's about the best time to see them.
The guys that are just going home are scared, and no matter how many firefights you get into and get shot at, you're still just as scared as the first guy coming over here.
Bruce Black.
Would you like to be right now?
Well, either back in bed or at home. Mostly at home, I think. Hey, Jim, get down. I think they're gonna drop this junk.
This makes me nervous too, even the Air Force up there. The bombs come in, I don't like that. They very seldom make mistakes, but it's always the first time. I hope they bomb it real heavy before we have to try and take it. There's no doubt about it. We'll have to go up it today. But tomorrow we'll probably have to take it now that we know something's up there. As long as you're over here, I don't think you'll ever get used to that bombing when they start bombing this close. That's when I really start shaking. That's what I mean. I don't like that stuff. I'm glad they're on our side. They hit it pretty heavy with some big stuff. These would be all right.
Two men are wounded in the ambush. They did not see the snipers who shot them. Another man is dead, hit in the head by fragments from a 500-pound bomb. A freak accident. One of the bombs from the airstrike exploding in the trees overhead.
There's one boy, one up that hill. He's down there talking before he went up it. He's fixing to go home. He just had a few days left. He's joking about it. He said, well, boy, this is the last hill I'll have to take. He got up there and got killed.
Get in the hole! Get in the hole!
An artillery barrage is fired to soften up the hill. One or two shells fall short, directly on the company position, scattering shrapnel meant for the enemy into the limbs and ribs of Alpha Company. In all, 13 are wounded. A lieutenant, two sergeants, 9 enlisted men, and 1 civilian. Sepp Tama, who has, until now, recorded the soundtrack for this film. The most serious casualty, a soldier who has lost his leg. The accident delays the advance on Hill 943 for 10 minutes.
Cone, you ready to go?
JC, move them people out over there. Spread them out.
Fire through Charlie, over.
All right, stay low and keep pushing right as you go. We got to swing north. Go. Low.
Alpha Company starts up the hill, stretched out on a skirmish line, side by side, advancing slowly behind a curtain of fire.
Five three, Bravo, over.
All right, let's hold it now.
Tell me what's happening, over.
It's 5-3. Roger, pull your people around that.
One platoon advances as another fires cover, leapfrogging one at a time up the hill. JC and 2nd Platoon are ordered to sweep around the right flank, past the crater of a giant bomb. The top of the hill is in sight.
JC, where are they?
Out there. I hope not. Ed Williams, the bottom portion starts coming this way, up. Okay. Hey, you moving now?
Reese, if you need ammo, I got some.
Well, check the damn thing out and then get down in it. Okay, go bite you.
JC's squad finds the enemy's fighting positions. Each must be searched in case the enemy is hiding.
Behind there.
You
gotta go in
now
with a grenade. You ain't gonna walk in it.
Go back.
Go back about 4 feet like they all.
The bunkers are empty.
You guys want to see what these holes look like? You can go down and look at one of these holes. It goes back.
40 yards from the top. There is to be a charge.
Move out, move out.
Move, 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 move. Buckner moves up. They are on top. Hill 943 is taken. It has taken 3 days. There is nothing to take. The body count is zero. No prisoners, no stragglers, no weapons. The enemy chose to withdraw rather than stand and fight for Hill 943. To the men, it is just as well.
And there's for a long time, I hit all the
We got ambushed. We're digging your hole.
In 4 days, after sweeping the area around 943, Alpha Company is being lifted out. The hill has been abandoned. The mission was to engage and destroy the enemy. And now that the enemy is gone, there is no reason for the Americans to stay.
How does it feel?
JC.
Pretty good. Going back to fire base. That's about the only time it feels good, though.
The day after Christmas, 3rd Battalion, 12th Infantry returned to Hill 943. The North Vietnamese had also returned, and they chose this time to fight for it. There was a serious battle. Many more men were killed, mostly enemy. After a few days, the Americans moved on to other objectives, and in late January, while assaulting a nameless hill near Dak Tho, Alpha Company was heavily mortared. J.C., the career soldier, was wounded, but returned to duty, and has since become platoon sergeant, one of two men in 2nd Platoon who survived since Hill 943. Bruce Black, who first resisted his assignment to Vietnam, was seriously wounded, evacuated to the States, and is serving out his remaining months in the Army as a drill instructor. And Jim Buckner, the enlisted man who planned to go back to his father's restaurant in Derby, New York, sit on the beach with a six-pack, eat pizza and chase girls. Jim Buckner was killed. There is a hill in Vietnam, a nameless, uninhabited hill known only by a number, 943, which was assaulted twice, taken twice, and abandoned twice by Americans. And today, 943 is again controlled by the North Vietnamese.
One of the most publicized measures of the war's progress was body count, the numbers of enemy dead. Numbers quoted frequently as evidence that we were winning the war. But often a reliable body count was hard to come by. The enemy would remove his dead from the battlefield. Sometimes he didn't have the chance, as Robert Shackney reported.
Very often after a heavy battle, it's hard to tell who won and who lost. But in this case, the evidence of victory is very clear.
There were 48 bodies of dead enemy soldiers piled up in the perimeter of the 1st Battalion, 2nd Infantry, awaiting burial. There are battles when it's difficult to know quite how badly the enemy has been hurt. But after the fight here last night, the troops of the U.S. 1st Division held the ground and could count the bodies of the men they had killed.
I might say here that in the 1st Division, we have a very ironclad policy of positively identifying our kills. We claim probables when we aren't completely sure, but have a high percentage of assurance. And whenever we claim body count, we have either actually picked up the body or we've had two men see the body on the battlefield before we left the battlefield area. So we do not, contrary to what may have been put out someplace in the press, we do not exaggerate.
In combat, there are no niceties. A dead enemy soldier is simply an object to be examined for documents, then removed as quickly as possible, sometimes crudely. No one says a prayer here or holds a funeral service. These had been living, breathing men yesterday. Today, they are just a sanitation problem. Robert Chakney, CBS News, near the Cambodian border.
A different kind of body count was to deepen the tragedy of Vietnam. The numbers of innocent civilians caught in the crossfire and killed in the course of the war. An estimated 500,000 civilians died. And for those who survived, it was sometimes almost a miracle. John Hark reported this story in 1967.
Nia is 6 years old. Yesterday, her parents were killed when the war came to the hamlet without a name in Quang Nai province. What it had was North Vietnamese troops shooting at Americans. 3 children were killed, along with Nia's mother and father, and another woman, caught in the crossfire of the fight over their hearts and minds. That was the first time she saw an American, freelance cameraman Douglas Sapper.
Someone said, fire on it, kill it. Then, off to my left, I heard someone say, it looks like a kid. At this time, I jumped up and started running towards where I had then recognized it to be a little girl walking between the Viet Cong fire and our own fire. I dashed forward, scooped her up in my arms, and started running back in a zigzag fashion, trying to avoid both the friendly fire and the enemy fire. Since there were very few survivors that we could locate, none of them really related to her, why we felt it would just be better if I kept her.
At Saigon's Third Field Hospital, Nia receives the first medical treatment of her life. The foreign taste of alcohol on the thermometer makes her cry for the first time since she saw her parents die. A blood test shows she is, like many Vietnamese children, extremely anemic. She is covered with scabies parasites. Her stomach is swelled with some kind of worms. She may have tuberculosis. 3 Americans want to adopt Nia, but that will take 6 months in the tangled bureaus of Vietnam. And there are thousands of others like her here.
Many casualties were accidents, victims in the wrong place at the wrong time. But some were killed by deliberate acts of murder. The communists conducted a campaign of terror in the countryside, assassinating local officials, and sometimes prisoners were simply massacred. Here's a report from Ike Pappas.
Deep in the Delta, evidence of how the Viet Cong treats its prisoners. They were massacred, trussed, and left to die in this common grave. They were inmates at a Viet Cong prison camp near Long My, 130 miles southwest of Saigon, most of them Vietnamese army men. American commanders on the scene said the Viet Cong had killed 41 persons. Some were tied, others chained. Captain Philip Brown of Kansas City, Missouri, is an American advisor with the Vietnamese army.
Condition of the bodies, what were they mutilated in any way?
Well, I only observed 4 or 5 bodies, and of the 4 or 5 I observed, one was mutilated. One was tied. Outside of that, I can't really can't say. We didn't go that deep.
When you say mutilated, in what way?
Well, someone cut the liver out of one of them. I'm not going to say who did it.
At first, the Army said 6 persons survived the massacre, but there was a 7th. He stumbled from his hiding place in a nearby patch of brush after Vietnamese troops swept through the camp. He is about 40 years old, has been a Viet Cong prisoner for a year. He is himself badly hurt. He has a deep gash in his head from a bayonet. The Viet Cong left him for dead.
When the VC departed, the man crawled into a nearby clump of bushes, and there he stayed until the helicopters came.
Kill the other prisoners.
They saw the VC through entrance and just found out and killed everyone.
Looking at this horrible hole in the Delta, it doesn't take much to be reminded of some of the ugly scenes, the horrible scenes during the Second World War. Ike Pappas, CBS News, near Long Mi in the Delta.
Not all the atrocities were committed by the communists. It's painful to say that, but it's nonetheless true. One of the worst examples happened in 1968, although we didn't find out about it until later. It happened here in a hamlet called My Lai. On March 16, 1968, a platoon led by Lieutenant William Calley entered My Lai and slaughtered hundreds of civilians. That story remained secret for more than a year until it was uncovered by an enterprising reporter named Seymour Hersh. The nation was shocked and stunned. How did My Lai happen? Mike Wallace talked with one of the men who was there, Sergeant Paul Meadlow.
So we moved on into the village. And we started searching out the village and gathering up the people and running them to the center of the village.
How many people did you round up?
Well, there was about 40-45 people that we gathered in a the center of the village, and we placed them in there, and it was like a little island right there in the center of the village, I say.
So what kind of people? Men, women, children?
Men, women, children.
Babies?
Babies. And we all huddled them up, made them squat down. And Lieutenant Calley came over and said, "You know what to do with them, don't you?" And I said, "Yes." So I took for granted that he just wanted us to watch him. And he left and came back about 10 or 15 minutes later and said, "How come you ain't killed him yet?" And I told him that I didn't think you wanted us to kill him, I thought you wanted us to guard him. He said, "No, he wanted him dead." So...
He told this to all of you or to you particularly?
Well, I was pacing him, but the other three or four guys heard it. And so he stepped back about 10, 15 feet and he started shooting him. And he told me to start shooting him. So I started shooting him. I fired about four clicks into it, to the group.
You fired four clips from your...
M16.
And that's about how many clips? I mean, how many...
I carried 17 rounds to each clip.
So you fired something like 60, 70
right.
shots. And you killed how many at that time?
Well, I fired them on automatic, so you can't... you just spray the area on them, so you really can't know how many you kill because it comes out so doggone fast. So I might have killed about 10, 15 of them.
Mm-hmm. Men, women, and children?
Men, women, and children.
And babies?
And babies.
Lieutenant Calley was court-martialed, and in 1971, he was convicted and sentenced to life imprisonment. That sentence was later reduced to 10 years. Calley was released in 1974 after serving one-third of his sentence. He was given a dishonorable discharge. My Lai happened just after the Tet Offensive of 1968. As you may recall, the communists attacked all over South Vietnam, including the major cities and most provincial capitals. They suffered a military defeat, but the size and strength of their offensive dashed many hopes that the war was nearly over. In the months that followed the Tet Offensive, President Johnson announced he would not run for re-election. General Westmoreland was brought home as Army Chief of Staff and replaced in Vietnam by General Creighton Abrams. And across the United States, the division between hawks and doves became more pronounced and sometimes more violent. It came to a boil in the streets of Chicago, where anti-war demonstrators had gathered for the Democratic Convention. They wound up in pitched battles with Mayor Richard Daley's police force. The investigating commission would later describe what happened as a police riot. The Democratic Convention itself was badly split between hawks and doves, and emotions were running
high. With George McGovern, we wouldn't have a National Guard. We wouldn't have to have Gestapo tactics in the streets of Chicago.
The nominee for president was Lyndon Johnson's vice president, Hubert Horatio Humphrey. But the scars of that convention would not heal before November. The Democratic Party was still divided. The election was close, but the winner was the Republican, Richard Nixon. His election would mark another turning point of the Vietnam War. But for now, the war raged on. A few weeks after the election, the nation paused to observe a quiet Thanksgiving. In Vietnam, Thanksgiving was not so quiet. Don Webster reported.
For Thanksgiving, all servicemen in Vietnam have a turkey dinner. In remote areas, they may get it a few days early or late, but the military goes out of its way to provide the best meal possible under the circumstances. This dinner is being prepared by the 1st Air Cavalry Division for Alpha Company, 2nd of the 5th, a unit which went out on patrol the day before. Unfortunately, Alpha Company is too busy for dinner right now. They've just been attacked by the Viet Cong. They've taken some casualties, but right now everyone is too busy to count how many. Alpha Company had sent out two patrols, and the Viet Cong hit the camp just as they were on their way back. The last 200 yards across the open field are the most dangerous.
Hold it up and spread it out.
Hold it up and spread it out.
Alpha Company had three men killed and three others wounded in the battle just ended. Instead of turkey dinner for 150, there will be just 144. Finally, the turkey dinner arrives, a few hours late, and on the same helicopter with more ammunition for Alpha Company. It's all there. Shrimp cocktail, 80-millimeter mortar shells, cranberry sauce, hand grenades, mince and pumpkin pie, 7.62 caliber bullets.
Before I say grace today, I would like for us to pause for a moment of silence in memory of our friends that were lost this morning. Let us pray. For the food which we are about to receive from your goodness, our Father, we give you thanks. Bless it to our lives and us to your service. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
There's a natural tendency when the fighting is ended for the moment to relax a bit, and the turkey dinner helps. For many men, it's a two paper plate day. The plates are small and the appetites large. This is a chance to relax, but not to forget what's just happened. One of the dead men was scheduled to go home soon.
It makes you wonder what's this all about over here. And somebody like that, that you just talked to, maybe an hour before it happens, it really shocks you, and you don't know, you can't tell your feelings.
Life sometimes seems pretty cheap over here, doesn't it?
Sometimes it does. Sometimes you wonder why you're over here, and then you really realize why you're over here. You're trying to save these people over here, so it don't happen to us back in the world, our families.
I guess on a day like this, you really have something to be thankful for.
Yes, I do. I really have something to be thankful for, that I'm still alive. I'm doing my best to stay alive for the next few days.
In the Bible, in Ecclesiastes, it is written, "For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal."
'68 was almost over. The American buildup had reached its peak, but the war was not yet won or lost or ended. The time to kill, the time to die, would continue for years to come. This is Walter Cronkite, and this has been another in our continuing series of video cassettes on the Vietnam War.